And one last thing before I go.
Has anyone else noticed how much cool AV tech there is in these rooms?
How are these things?
Like audience microphones to pick up questions.
Actually, that's the NSA.
Oh, I got it.
Hey, everything is dual purpose.
They want you to think that you
I will raise up my hand in 5 minutes.
Absolutely not.
Then the
exactly.
Early morning.
I imagine I will be done way too early now.
Okay, perfect. So,
which I think suits the situation anyway. Right, and please, if you are watching on the stream, I know there's a few people, feel free to ask using the hashtag as well. I will monitor it for questions during the day. Sorry about all the fuss. Thank you very much. Shall I just hit it? Okay, my name is Michael Cook. I work with Simon Colton at Goldsmiths at the University of London and Imperial College sometimes as well, but we don't go there anymore, like Ravenholm. And I'm here to talk to you today about, not about my PhD work per se, but a little project called A Rogue Dream, and the actual title, Automatically Generating Meaningful Content for Games. This talk is a bit of a mess. I had a 22-hour day with 2 hours of sleep yesterday and a lot of coffee, and there could be anything in here, really. I don't really remember making half of these slides. But there's going to be three basic things I want to talk about. Procedural content generation and content generators in particular that work with meaningful information. A rogue dream, what it is only a little toy, but I want to show you it, and it will be playable at some point if you're interested. And can we do stuff with real-world information? Should we be doing stuff? What should we be doing? Why should we be doing it? But the problem I have at the moment is that procedural generation is meaningless. It's completely meaningless. Not by which I mean, you know, pack up and go home because we're done and there's no point and life is just a series of handcrafted content from which the speech bubble's the wrong way around. From which there is no escape. It's supposed to be pointed to the coffin. What I mean is it's meaningless in the sense that when we think about content generators, we like to think that they produce things like this. This is a screenshot from Spelunky. So was the previous one, in fact, if you're not familiar with the game. And it's exquisite. It's my favorite example of procedural content generation being used to great effect in a game, not just being shoved in there, but really, really an integral part of the game. And we like to think that Spelunky's content generator is making these beautiful jungle landscapes where, you know, you're adventuring through, trying to find the exit. But it's not. It's not. It's making things like this. It knows whether there's a start and an end, and there's arrows that connect abstract locations together, and there might be some booleans that tell you that this part isn't on the critical path. And this is actually from Spelunky's designer, wrote a blog about the level generator, and this is a diagram that he drew of what it does. It doesn't create these amazing landscapes and think about what the player's going to be feeling as they rustle through the grass and leap over the zombies. It just thinks about the cold hard facts. And I don't have any lead-in for these bullet points. You're going to have to pretend that they're appearing one at a time. So you might not worry much about this. There's no like punchlines or anything, but you might think, well, you know, so what? But you know, there's more to content than just abstract data structures and numbers and integers and whatnot. And I think that there's some interesting stuff out there to be had if our content generators could work with real-world information. And we've seen some examples of this. There are systems that work or try and work with real-world knowledge to generate content afresh. And I think that it's not just about the kind of games that we could make, but the kinds of unusual discoveries we might come across along the way, new projects for people to look into, new kinds of experience that might not be games, but might be something else. So, a rogue dream is a rogue-like, light-like light, by which I mean it's a very, very bad game that I made, really just as a toy prototype, and I'm still, you know, I still like it. It still does the job, but it's not a big game. You move around this randomly generated map, and you attack enemies, and you can heal yourself by collecting items and things like that. But there is no surface level design. The game isn't about being an adventurer and an explorer running through jungles. The game's surface level design is decided at runtime using input from the player. So at the start of the game, the game poses you this question this phrase. Last night I dreamt I was a, and then it asks you to complete the question. And I was going to give a demo, but the demo's on that machine. So I'll give you a demo later, maybe during the coffee breaks or lunch or something. It's not spectacular, but it's fun to play with. And so you give it a noun, like a cat, for instance. And after it thinks for a little bit and it crunches some numbers, you come up with something like this. I told you it was basic. So I don't know, you probably can't see on the stream, but the contrast is pretty bad. But this is a little sprite of a cat. This is cat grass that you can collect. You can eat it to gain health. These are water droplets. They are your enemies. They hurt you. And you've got an ability called throw that you can use as a ranged attack as well as just bumping into the enemies. So it's pretty basic, and the cat example is pretty basic as well. I mean, you know, you could imagine all manner of ways in which you could build a system that came up with this game. But I'm going to tell you how a rogue dream works, and you can decide whether it's worth going on about or not. But I think there's some interesting ideas in here. It's based on an idea called Google milking, which I came across through Tony Veal in Computational Creativity. What he does is he asks Google incomplete questions, and then he reads autocorrect to find out what other people wrote to complete those questions. So why do cats, well, why do cats purr? Why do cats eat grass? Why do cats meow? Why do cats like boxes? Why do they have whiskers? And the interesting thing about Google milking is that people are asking questions, but what that means is it's reflecting a commonly held belief about cats, either something that people have observed directly or a stereotype that they think. So, you know, if you put in English people, you will get why do English people have bad teeth. So I like to think that's not a direct observation. I like to think that is just a prejudice stereotype. Let's not go too deep into that one. But one way or another, it's representing things that people have put into Google, things that people have written. And Tony's very interested in this because it reveals knowledge that can be mined for things like linguistics and metaphor generation. He does amazing work in those kinds of areas. But what I did was I augmented some of these searches to in such a way that they would link into common game concepts. So instead of why do cats always and just taking whatever comes, you add in a little bit extra. Why do cats always hate water? Why do cats always want to chase mice? Why do cats always eat grass? Or why do rabbits eat their own poop? That's a common one that Google likes to add. Loads of animals eat their own poop, it turns out. So you do get repetitive results sometimes. So a rogue dream takes all of these results. It collects the auto-completion part. Google doesn't like you doing it, so you have to essentially steal from them. But that's fine. And then it feeds them into a little tool they made called Sprightly, which is a very basic open source thing for auto-generating little sprites based on freely available image sources. So it's Java-based, but you can download a command line version. So this game actually uses the command line version. It's not written in Java. There's a GUI version that's a bit iffy. And it goes to places like Google Images and Wikimedia Commons, and it takes the word you give it and it adds little modifiers to it. So for instance, we just through experimentation, if you type in cat into Google Images, you get terrible results. But if you type cartoon cat or silhouette of cat, you get really good results, where you can extract the background, crush it down to a 32 by 32 sprite or whatever, and optionally recolor it. So that's pretty much the chain. You do some Google milking, you feed it through Sprightly, and you load them into a rogue dream. The next slide does have a joke in it, which is ruined because there's no build. So here's a picture of Kenny G. But you know, so what? Cats eat grass, they're afraid of water, we know all of these things. Couldn't we just write a database that tells us these facts? And then we wouldn't have to worry about the time where it says, why are French people lazy? Why are English people have bad teeth? Why do X, Y, Z? Why do men always cheat on women? Why do priests abuse children? These are all genuine results from a rogue dream, and you may not want these in your game, understandably. Why do musicians hate Kenny G? So this musician is just being chased by thousands of Kenny Gs around this maze. I think there are loads of reasons. I'm going to give you a few now. Google is now. Milking Google or social media sources or crowdsourcing, which I think is a very similar philosophy to this. It tells you what is going on right now. If you write a database before President Obama gets his second term, you have a different estimation of Obama than afterwards. Why does Obama hate the rich? Why does Obama hate the Kardashians? It's a good question. It tells you things that are happening now. I wrote the first version of A Rogue Dream about a year and a half ago, and if you asked it to make a game about journalists, it would tell you that they hated Syria. And this is because people felt like journalists weren't covering the conflict in Syria, they were just ignoring it. So what's their problem with Syria? Now if you write about it, it's why do journalists hate social media, or why do journalists hate the newsroom? So the zeitgeist, or whatever you want to call it, has shifted. People are asking Google different questions. That's because they're observing different things, or the popular belief is different, and so you get different results. And kind of leading on from that, there's a build on this slide. I remembered to do this one last night. Google's very cultural. So if you ask ConceptNet about the internet, which is like a common repository of kind of common sense knowledge, it's really handy. We use it on lots of things. In fact, I'll be mentioning it in another talk later today. You get things like, the internet is a network of communicating computers, which is fine. If you ask Google, it'll say, tell you that the internet loves cats and bacon and My Little Pony. And, you know, the internet is a network of communicating computers, but if you want to know what it means to people to use it in a game, these are perhaps at least as useful and interesting, if not more, if you want to relate it to people. And Google's vast. So earlier we made a game about cats, and we were told that cats don't like water. So water was the enemy. But if you ask Google about Siberian cats, people seem to believe that Siberian cats like water. People have observed this in their pet Siberians, whatever. They chirp, apparently, as well. And this is a fact. A Siberian cat owner asks you to make a game about its cat. What are you going to do? Your handcrafted database is going to tell you that they hate water, but Google knows better. North Carolina hates Florida. Is this? Can anyone confirm this? Anyone from NC here? No?
Everyone hates Florida.
Fair enough. Why does everyone hate North Carolina was also a result, which I thought was a bit harsh.
State are different.
Yeah, that was the Duke thing as well, I think. Yeah, very much. And so in the off the back of some very helpful reviews, the paper actually includes an analysis of how often A Rogue Dream fails, which I haven't included here, but, you know, it fails. Yeah, there are screw-ups. I'm not really proposing that everyone uses Google in their games, but I do think that grabbing live data from the internet is interesting. So yeah, there's more out there than what drunk people type into search engines at 4 a.m. But the philosophy of using real-world data in our procedural generators is really important, and because it gives you flexibility and dynamism, and it allows you to interact with people directly on a cultural level. I'm going to make a claim. I'm on the 20th season of Law and Order at the moment. The last 12 months have just been mainlining Law and Order every day, pretty much. Why are there no procedurally generated crime and mystery games? There are a couple, but the reason why they don't work is because they're not really about mysteries, because the mystery part, you know, the twist in every Law and Order episode, is normally an obscure cultural artifact of whoever's currently involved in the case. This week it's about a religious group, this week it's about people from some country that's in Europe somewhere, this week it's often about Muslims, but let's slide past that. And it uses a fact about that target group or community or ideology or whatever to produce something, some twist in the tale. And we can't do that because our systems don't understand anything about that. They're limited to making jungles out of arrays of integers. And for me, my day job, so to speak, my PhD is about building an automated game designer that I want to be taken seriously as an independent designer on its own. And how is it going to do that if everyone knows that it has no understanding of what it means to be human or to exist in culture or whatever? That was a bit breathless. I'm going to skip past that slide on the future, only because before I go to questions, I just want to very quickly talk about this. This is super, super important. In November, I'm organizing a game jam. And the tagline is make something that makes something, because the game jam is about procedural generation. And you don't have to make a game to enter. You can make a game with procedural generation in it, or you can make a tool. You can make a music generator, you can make a narrative generator, you can bring in your research and build a mini playable tool with it and release it to people, or don't release it to people, or tell people about it. It's going to be amazing. It's going to happen all over the internet, and people are getting excited. And even if you don't want to join in the jam, on November the 8th, please tune in on Twitch, because we're going to be streaming an afternoon of talks from indies, from artists, from academics. Gillian's going to be giving a talk, fingers crossed. Yes, okay. And it's going to be great. They're all going to be recorded. It's going to be, if nothing else, a really cool resource of procedural generation material. But I also really, really hope that some of you are going to get involved as well, because I know that you've all got terrific projects hidden on your hard drives, or maybe that you're working on right now, that could be turned into something really cool and interesting. So if you want to see more, itch.io/jam/procjam, or you can find procjam on Twitter, and it's got loads of stuff on there. But please, please, please talk to me about it if you're interested. How was that for time? Am I there?
Yeah.
All right. I'll cut it there, and I'll show you the demo this time.
To ask Michael or to ask Google?
Had some fun last night. Yeah, sorry.
So how far do you envision pushing the meaning connections? Because I could imagine you searching inside there. So right now you're making, you put in cats and you can find out cats ate water. Could you also put in an association between water is good for grass and therefore there's some interesting game mechanic connection that you can make inside there?
Yes, I think so. That's really interesting. It reminds me, so later on I'm going to be talking about some of my colleagues' work. And what they've been doing is they've actually been using ConceptNet. But the latest thing they've done is once they found connections, they tried to chain them together to make longer ones. And I hadn't considered doing that for a rogue dream, but that should be done, I think. Yes, that's really interesting. Another problem that's related to it is, well, you talked about how far it could go, is getting it, I've fudged it because I've said, oh, by the way, when these two things bump into each other, that's equivalent to attacking them. And I've linked that to the concept of hating or disliking. That's actually the bit I'm really interested in mining automatically, and that's what comes afterwards, and that's much harder. So that's another step as well. That might have been on the future slide, I'm not sure. Maybe, yeah.
So what's the lower bound of submissions for a particular search phrase in the Google before it actually becomes an autocorrect style dropdown?
I'm not sure. I know they're ordered in terms of popularity.
Yeah.
So we normally take the cream from the top, but obviously when it gets more specific, like Siberian cats, I don't know.
So it could be like one person.
I think it's at least 40. And
okay.
The reason I say 40 is because Tony Veal works with Google Ngrams,
yeah,
which are not the book Ngrams. They are, you post away to Google and they send you 22 DVDs of text files, which are phrases they've mined off the internet. And their minimum barrier there is 40 people. So my guess is if they used it there, maybe they use it for their autocorrect. But surprise, surprise, Google is not very forthcoming with information. So I don't know. My guess would be 40, but I'm not sure.
Do you know if Google's autocorrect censors itself? Because one of the problems is that you're now working with the culture of the internet, and you could end up with it creating a game which is very insensitive, purely by accident.
That talks not up.
So we actually had that problem. It turns out even if it censors itself, even if it thinks it's censoring itself on the obvious stuff, like picking out words, it won't censor itself on concepts. So for instance, why do priests abuse children is an issue. Like, that is seriously offensive to people. It's also arguably true in a lot of cases, but it's not fair to make why do all priests abuse people. And that is, it's one of the pitfalls of using the approach, and it's also what makes it spicy and exciting and interesting. So when it tells you, one of the examples in the paper I think is about Americans, which and I can't remember what it comes up with. There's some good stuff in there. A lot of people like a rogue dream because one person described it as playing a game against the internet, because you are faced with what the internet thinks of things, not necessarily what is factually accurate, which is fascinating. But yeah, there are definitely issues.
Yeah.
But yeah, it makes it interesting, but it needs to be plastered with trigger warnings, because it's got issues. Yeah.
There's a few related issues. One is that some of these things are really the drunk rules. Behaviors. Some of them are actually kind of serious, and like, you know, cats don't like water, which is a common thing they'll believe, versus something weird that people want to know about cats. I don't know why. But your system won't be able to tell the difference between, you know, things that are kind of funny and not funny. But then also, I think, you know, some of the things that you're going to get are not truly sentences that people enter, but are going to be more of Ngram things. Like, I know the longer and longer things you get, you start getting more and more weird suggestions, which I'm pretty sure no one has ever typed, but it's saying, I've seen these two words in a sentence somewhere.
That's interesting. I had not considered Google doing that. There's a related problem where the reason that cats have the ability to throw is because it says, why do cats throw up?
Right. you know, I think accidentally, the reason a lot of those things, the way you start the sentences, are going to be tapped into the part of Google where it's actually pulling
But
there is the risk of basically getting things that you think are culturally meaningful or correct or something like that, which are actually just kind of more engrammy.
That's interesting. One of the things I thought about is, so for those that don't know, Mark's done amazing work on crowdsourcing, Mark and his group, indeed. One of the things I thought was interesting is that if you ask people flat out in a crowdsourcing act, like, what do cats do? My guess is, and I don't know, so you could probably tell me, that you need a much larger number of people to get agreement. So what I thought was, maybe if you go to Google first to mine things that you think people believe, then you'd ask people just give you a yes or no. Maybe it lowers the barrier of confirmation. So maybe I thought of, you could maybe get something out of combining the two approaches. It's obviously not live then,
right.
But maybe over time you could build a richer,
Well, I'm fascinated by the notion of Google milking, and I wonder if you can pair that with other sources, like maybe you can hit Bing and Google and try to see if there's correlation or...
That would be interesting.
I don't know. I'm kind of curious as to how you'd be able to tell whether you're building a snarky game or a serious game.
Yeah, which is seriously important for people, right? If you're trying to build a Sherlock Holmes game and you want to mine real-world information, you don't want it to find out. I mean, dogs do eat their own poop sometimes, or they appear to, but you don't necessarily want that to be a clue in a Sherlock Holmes game. There's a minefield of problems out there. Do you have a question? I thought you might.
In light of Tommy and Mike's questions, I'm trying to figure out how to formulate it, but
okay.
I guess it's something along the lines of what's interesting about Google milking is that it gets sort of human opinion in the aggregate, but what's actually often more interesting is outlier opinion. And I think this runs along with what you're saying about why there's some sure everyone's going to search for why do cats hate water, but there may be something much more interesting that a fewer number of people are searching for. And it also runs along with what Tommy was saying. There's my very real worry about this kind of system is that the internet is a cesspool of hatred, especially towards certain groups. And I am actually very worried about the idea of having generators that are built on an engine where the autocomplete for why do women is why do women cheat, why do women wear thongs, and why do women have periods, right? So I'm wondering if you have thoughts on how you might structure a system that has more meaning for the AI itself rather than assuming that the cultural aggregate is meaningful.
Yeah, so there's a reason why this was not built into Angelina directly, and it was built as a standalone, in quarantine, basically. and that's because it cannot be trusted. Yes, and this is partly, again, part of... So when I originally built the system, I envisaged asking it about cats, about dogs. Then when I brought it in front of people, they said, okay, tell me what it says about teachers, or tell me what it says about prime ministers. And then I started to realize that there were loads of issues associated with it. Yes, it's massively important. It has to be addressed. It's a minefield. It's also an interesting minefield because it's other people in competition creativity have come up against it, including Tony Veal. He's got a Twitter bot called Metaphor Magnet, I think, that generates metaphors using a similar approach. There were issues raised about Twitter bots offending people, or even humans offending each other, and people pointed out there's no research into detecting this kind of thing, or very little research, at least. Yeah, I don't have any answers, but it is something that I have major concerns about as well. I want to solve it. I don't want to ignore it and not explore this area. I want to push forward and find ways of mitigating it. It's interesting because in some cases the minority opinion is the terrible one, and in some cases the majority opinion is the terrible one. And then there's issues where the opinion isn't terrible, I just strongly disagree with it. And I mean me personally, as someone writing. So you're processing these things and you're like, okay, that's got to go. And then I stop myself because I realize this actually is just my own personal bias, which is obviously right, but it doesn't mean Yeah, lots of issues. There was a paper I was working on that I didn't get through ICCC this year, but I meant to put up on my website. It got rejected, but I think it's interesting work, maybe, or it will be one day, about generating bits of code that express opinions. And that had a similar problem where all it promised was that it would generate you an opinion. It didn't tell you that you'd like it. And at the moment, that was just operating on pieces of data. But if it starts operating on pieces of culture, and suddenly Angelina turns around one day and decides that it's become a fascist overnight, like, more you, like, yeah, needs to be addressed. But yes, thank you for mentioning it so directly. Go.
Going beyond what you're doing here for just seeding simple games, I think Jillian hit on something, is that if you were to try to use it in a Watson sort of way to generate intelligent dialogue in an open world game, you stop somebody on the street and you start having a conversation with them. That's perfectly acceptable to, hey, you know what? Mine the aggregate of what is out there to generate realistic responses. If you ask, you know, somebody in GTA 12, you know, well, what do you think about such and such? And it gives you, like, you know, a political opinion based on the demographics and the region that the game is taking place. That's actually a legitimate thing. But I do agree with her that what happens, though, from an interesting game design standpoint is that you have scrubbed out, you know, a lot of the individuality. You're not going to, you know, walk up to somebody and have this conversation and have, you know, go, wow, well, that's really compelling.
Yeah.
I've never heard that before. You're an interesting person. You are, you stand out for some reason that furthers a game narrative. Now, we hooked up to the planner that we talked about earlier. But I think that there's interesting potential just in using the big data approach to seeding background characters.
So there's a colleague of mine who now works up in Abate, I think. I hope that she doesn't come across this in case I've got it wrong. But she works in argumentation, and I wonder maybe, yeah, once you've found some of these opinions, maybe you can use argumentation to generate adjacent ones or opposite ones or tangential ones. I still think maybe you're underestimating Google. I think there are some opinions you wouldn't want anywhere, even in a GTA game. And there's also, so to go on to
a GTA game, but
to go on to a computational creativity tangent, there's merit in being, you know, that shock art is a thing, offending people is a thing, but if the system isn't aware that it's doing it, then it's
right.
completely meaningless. And so, at the very least, you need to be able to recognize it enough to get rid of it, even if you're not planning on getting rid of it. You need to. Otherwise, people are just going to say this, the system is stupid and it's offensive, rather than the system is clever and it's offensive. Even if they're willing, like, so I think either way we need to find out how to recognize these things.
I agree that the detection of what's acceptable and not, I wasn't even going into that. I was just saying, never mind that. Let's assume we can manage to solve that at some point. Just the usage of, you know, I mean, like in a Watson sort of way, or actually probably more appropriate to this would be Family Feud. The top 100 people
right.
surveyed
exactly.
said, well, gee, I'll just put it into Google. And,
it
know.
Does have that feeling of it.
Incidentally, by the way, if you say, why do game programmers, why do programmers, you get a lot of interesting stuff. If you say, why do AI programmers or AI researchers, you get nothing. So apparently we're like completely under Google's radar.
There you go. Still seating. Can I just, sorry, that was your question before.
More like a suggestion, because I've noticed there was some work, I know how good it was actually, but there was some work on children search engines, which is, I think, a good keyword to help you find stuff that filters aggressive content.
Yes, that could be very interesting, and preconceptions and stereotypes.
Yeah. And I noticed a work where they trained models, basically NLP more or less, they trained models to check coherence of generated text.
Okay.
Yeah, and I can find it, I can find it for you. And so it's possible to do something. It's not like great, but it goes towards the way we want to go. So.
Okay, that sounds very interesting. Yeah, that sounds really, really interesting.
I just want to make one quick comment on the two people who mentioned outliers or the fact that it's annoying that you can sort of only get majority opinions. Tony Beale's done some really interesting stuff on taking not the most common things that show up in the engrams corpus, but sort of going down a little bit and looking for ones that are slightly less common, but still common enough to be recognized. And there's obviously a thresholding problem there, but he's written a couple of papers on it, and it's kind of interesting if you're into this stuff.
Tony Beale's secretly one of my favorite human beings.
Yeah,
it's
totally not secretly for me, actually.
And now we broadcast.
Secretly.
I'm happy with it on record. I just wanted to say, we were very rushed this morning, but before we go, thank you all for coming. The lineup's incredible. Thank you for so many people for turning up. We're really proud of the workshop. Like, I'm really looking forward to the rest of the day. Not this talk, obviously. But, yeah, okay. I guess we'll call it that. Thank you.
Yeah.
So I'm currently checking with Michael if we can show up to the coffee break a little late. So right now the plan is to continue going forward, but if I hear back from him that we are not able to, we will try and just run over there and get coffee.